So an official hello and welcome to the Center for Critical Thinking's Zoom webinar. We are coming to you today from beautiful Naples, Florida, and you can see from the image on your screen that you have successfully zoomed in to today's presentation, Historic Rehabilitation in Naples, featuring our keynote speaker, Elaine Reed. My name is Carol Lair. I'm the Vice President of the Center for Critical Thinking, and it's my pleasure to act as your moderator for today's topic. The Zoom format that we are using is the webinar. Now, early in the days of internet events, they created the term webinar. It's shorthand for web seminar. And this format is a little different from the typical Zoom meeting that so many of you have been using during the pandemic. In a webinar, you, our wonderful attendees, cannot see each other, and we, your wonderful hosts, cannot see you. But you will have the opportunity to interact with Elaine Reed following her talk by using your chat button or your question and answer feature at the very bottom of your Zoom screen. I'd like to share a little information about the Center for Critical Thinking. Founded in 2006 by Rita and Bernie Turner, we are a group of pleasantly diverse individuals concerned with the events of the day. We provide a forum for debate and discussion, and we promote the understanding of and the value of critical thinking skills. For most of our 14-year history, our programs took place at delicious dinner discussions or lively library talks. But now that it is safer to meet virtually, we are offering our speakers and our programs over Zoom and our own YouTube channel. Like all our online presentations, today's talk is being recorded so that you can enjoy it again or refer a friend to it. This is the second in our series of webinars, and we're delighted to have Elaine Reed, President and CEO of the Naples Historical Society, as our speaker. As many of you know, the Naples Historical Society is the central voice of Naples history with its educational headquarters in the beloved and beautiful historic Palm Cottage, the oldest house in Naples, built in 1895. Under her leadership from 2007 to the present, the Society has experienced unprecedented program and organizational growth. And with her Master of Public Administration degree, Elaine rebuilt the Society and created several preservation initiatives, which she will share with us today. Before making Naples her full-time home in 1999, Elaine had extensive international experience in Europe and the former Soviet Union. We're proud to announce that she is the newest member of the board of directors of the Center for Critical Thinking. And on a personal note, Elaine became a dear colleague and a friend when she offered the full support and the priceless archives of the Society as a key resource in the creation of the book, Naples Beach Homes, Cottages, Castles, and the Families That Built Them, written by two very grateful authors, Robert and yours truly, Carol Lair. Now, for those of you who have joined in during my opening remarks, I just want to repeat the ground rules. We are using the Zoom webinar format, which means that you participants do not see each other, and Elaine and I do not see you, but we know you're out there. At the conclusion of Elaine's presentation, we will be able to answer your questions and field your comments if you will use the chat button or the question and answer feature at the bottom of your Zoom screen. When you click on chat or Q&A, a window will open and you can just type in your question or comment. Then remember to press enter and I will pass them on to Elaine. So now sit back, relax, and here's Elaine Reed.
Well, thank you very much, Carol. I appreciate that introduction and congratulations again on that wonderful book that you and Robert put together. It's really spectacular. The material that I have for you today could really cover 2 hours because there's so much into it. So we had said that this is going to be at lightning speed. So I ask you to get pen and paper together. I will answer as many questions as the webinar will allow. And we'll start with that, all right? So what you see in front of you now is a material that describes what the society does. Most of you, I hope every one of you, have heard about Naples Historical Society's historic Palm Cottage. The Palm Cottage is a 3,500 square foot house museum that serves as our educational headquarters. Typically, when I have presentations, I will ask by show of hand how many people have been here, but I will assume everyone is raising their hand right now. And if you have not been there, I would encourage you to put that on your list for 2021. Of course, we've got an archival repository project. Carol mentioned the archives in her opening statement. This is a long-term project where I hope to be able to showcase our entire archival collection free to the public. This is going to take significant resources, and we're just in the beginning phases of this. If you want to know more about that, please let me know at some other point in time. Pupils at Palm Cottage, of course, we always say history isn't for the mature audience only. Children, particularly fourth graders, are studying Florida history. We try to meet the Florida standards by giving them Naples history so that this can be a wonderful supplement to the teachers. We have a very interesting collaboration that is just beginning with the Collier County Public School System to digitize this particular children's presentation. What we're going to talk about today is the Naples Historic District. The Naples Historic District is significant for many reasons. One is that Naples is 150 years old, approximately. Our tours begin post-Civil War. Now, the land has been around going back to the Colusa Indian, all right? We don't cover that in our history, because the Collier County Museum covers that. We focus our story, the telling, after the Civil War. But let me put some perspective into this. I have people who will come to the cottage and they will comment that Naples really isn't that old, so what's there to preserve? And I naturally think that someone is from the Northeast when I hear this comment. So if I say, are you from Boston, for example, and they answer yes or no, my comment is compared to Boston, Naples is relatively new. However, I had the good fortune of living overseas for a number of years, Eastern Europe and former Soviet Union, and one of those places was Yerevan, Armenia. I say to these folks who think Naples is new, Yerevan, Armenia was established in 782 BC, and they think Boston is brand new, right? So the whole idea with this is you've got to put perspective in what we're talking about. St. Augustine is a lot older than Boston. So let's take a look at Naples within Collier County and appreciate what we've got for that. That it has 150 years does not discount the rich stories of the people who were here in such a very unique area at the time. And for those of you who've been here for decades, goodness knows you've got some wonderful stories to share with us as well. All right, the Naples Historic District is an initiative started in 2013 during my tenure. All right, there have been about 30 years of attempts to have preservation related regulation surrounding the Naples Historic District, and it hasn't worked until this year. And I'd like to share with you what I can on the story about that. All right, the Naples Historic District has several goals, and the goals that you see on your screen are the same goals that we've had since the beginning, all of 7 years ago. These goals are important because however you look at it, we've got to find a way to coalesce and save the unique virtue and character of this charming area. For those of you, perhaps there are some who live in or near the Naples Historic District, this area has undergone substantial attack, certainly a decade ago or so, and there has to be a way to offer not only incentive, but extraordinary education and legislation to rope that desire in to tear down and build new. So I'd like to offer a little bit more perspective. In Florida, you can see this. We've got 67 counties in the state of Florida. There are 52 historic districts, all right? This is referring to districts, not houses. 52 historic districts. You can see the numbers right in front of you. St. Augustine, which probably many of you have seen, they have 17 historic districts. I'm sorry, they have 8 historic districts, fewer than in Sarasota County, which I found interesting because St. Augustine has such a conglomeration of beautiful architecture and history. Miami-Dade, right across the alley, has 10 historic districts. Miami-Dade, who would think that? All right, so let's go to Collier County. How many do we have? We have 1 historic district. Collier County measures 2,305 square miles, and we have 1 historic district. By the way, for those of you who might be interested, there are 90,000 individual listings in the state of, in the entire United States, 90,000. That's individual buildings and districts. That's massive. That's part of public information that's available for you to peruse if you so choose. There are other individual buildings that are listed in Collier County, including the Ted Smallwood Store, Everglades Laundry, Roberts Ranch, Key Wade and Club, and of course, Historic Palm Cottage, and the Captain John Foley Whorehouse in Key Marco. So let's go to the Naples Historic District. The district was created in 1987. Now, the district, of course, existed well before then, but the geographic boundary that you see in front of you was officially recognized at the state and national level in 1987. 30 years of attempts, as I mentioned earlier, were made to try to figure out how to govern preservation in this area. A district is merely a geographic demarcation of the border. That's it. It doesn't have any legislation. That comes separate. When I started to get approvals from the state and the national levels in 2017, there were 64 historic contributing structures in Naples, and now there are 61. And of course, you see at the bottom of the box, the district is less than one tenth of one square mile. We've got 2,305 square miles in Collier County, 14 square miles in the city of Naples, and this district is less than one tenth of one square mile. Surely we can do something to offer some incentives to maintain this particular area. All right. Challenges with preserving the Naples Historic District. People ask me this all the time. What could possibly go wrong? Now, there are about 5 varied factors in front of you. Growth, we'll take these one at a time. There's been over 11,000% increase in the population in the last 35 years. 11,000%, all right? That is absolutely astronomical. Think about this. Can you picture where the Naples Beach Hotel is today? That was on the border of town a few decades ago. The Beach Hotel was the border of town. There's a wonderful story about a gentleman who used to be on my board, for those of you who may know, Peter Thomas. He has since passed away, sadly. I called looking for him one day, and his wife, Stella, answered. And I said, Stella, I'm trying to reach Peter today. May I speak with him? And she said, Elaine, he left this morning. He's on a trip, and I'll give him the message. And I said, don't worry about it. I'll try next week when he returns. And she said, well, I will call you today. And I said, did he go on a long trip? And she said, yes, he went all the way to Pine Ridge Road. Now, that gives great perspective on people who've been here for a long time. And I know some of you, Amy Turner, I know that you probably know that story. Yes, this is all very, very true. So growth is a big factor because it brings in people who may not have the same affinity to this beautiful district that those who've lived with it might have. All right, market economics. The historic district is less than a half mile from $50 million residences. Now, some of those are people who are part of Naples Historical Society, and that's perfectly fine. In fact, they're enormously helpful, and thank God for their charity. But it's important to recognize the market economics of Naples, because Naples is not just preserving a district unto itself. You've got to factor in what's happening around that, and that includes the real estate property. Demand and supply comes into hand here, and you've got to acknowledge that. That's an absolute part of it. Number three, construction and maintenance. A lot of people comment that houses might not have been made well a long time ago. Well, most of the time, that's not true. There are some old houses built decades and decades ago that are brilliantly solid. I mean, I thought when Irma came in 2017, I was here in Naples when the hurricane came. And on Sunday, I believe it was the day that things started to settle, I managed my way downtown to assess the society's properties. And I did pass several houses in the district, and some of them are small. And certainly they don't have hurricane anything because they were built so long ago, but they stood proudly. Vegetation took a bit of a hit, but the houses were still there. Maintenance can become somewhat of an issue. Not everybody maintains the way that you may choose to maintain. You can't tell your neighbor, or you can't have the city say, you must change your roof, or you must change your windows. Naples is a very staunch property rights area. And we can talk about more about property rights probably with questions toward the end. Number four, geography. The Naples Historic District, of course, is adjacent to the Gulf of Mexico, and we have hurricanes. Sea salt and wind and just the air itself is enough to have an impact on some of these houses over time. Because we are where we are, whether we deal with termites or we're dealing with salt air, over time, this can take some wear and tear on the exterior and interior of some of these historic houses, which require more maintenance. Number five, and I've highlighted that in particular, I call it gentle misinterpretations. And process issues refers to the municipality in terms of dealing with people who want to rehabilitate their house. Misinterpretations, this is very significant. A long time ago, in 1989, this is 2 years after the district was recognized, there were good people throughout the county, in the city of Naples, who wanted to not recreate the wheel, but they wanted to look at other communities that had historic preservation ordinances. And so why recreate the wheel now that you've got a district that's been recognized? So they likely, no one's told me this, but I believe that they probably want to areas that are nationally recognized. Let's just say Savannah, Old Town Alexandria, Charleston, you can name Durango, Colorado, the list goes on. These communities have had preservation embedded in their social, cultural, institutional fabrics for decades. It is not the case here. So in 1989, when there were the first attempt, there was a lot of discussion on the expectations that met the same as some of these communities I just mentioned. Very tight restrictions on what you could and couldn't do. In Naples, that brought outcry from a great majority of people, including people who live in the Naples Historic District, because it was an attack on private property rights, okay? So that is one example. The media misreporting, and the media misreported, not of course with intention, but because the facts of historic preservation were just not very well known. And to this day, they still aren't. We've been making a great headway in trying to educate people, which is what this particular webinar is all about. There, of course, at the time was an institutional disregard to learn about preservation. There is no, has not been a dedicated preservation person at the city of Naples. That has changed, I'm happy to say. Not a full-time position, but there are staff members who now understand the importance of paying attention to this, because there are many people in the city of Naples who are screaming to pay attention to the charm and character while we've got it, and we can. Process issues were addressed with the legislation. So let's talk about the legislation. In March of this year, March of 2020, legislation was passed finally after 30 plus years to help homeowners manage their historic houses, particularly in the district. This legislation included a couple of things here. One is the 50% rule. The 50% rule refers to a Florida Building Code, Chapter 12, Florida Building Code regulation that says a homeowner and the homeowner team, contractor, architect, they have only an allowance of 50% of the construction value of the house. 50% of the budget is 50% of the construction value of the house to take care of rehabilitation. So, and you've got to separate construction value from real estate value. Real estate value, everybody understands. Construction value is what does it cost to rebuild that building as it exists, not the dirt, just the building. So some of these cottages, some of these tiny little cottages might be worth, one exact example is one is worth the construction value of $200,000. This is a real example. The dirt on which it sits brings it up to about $2.5 million, all right? So this small cottage has a construction value of $200,000. 50% of that means they have $100,000 budget allowance to spend on rehabilitation. Well, you can do what you want to an historic house on the interior when you do not use federal dollars. No one down here is using federal dollars, right? So you can put in Italian marble on the inside if someone so chose, all right? We're not advocating one way or the other. It's the exterior that we are looking at in Naples because market economics drive us to that. Of course, we'd like everything to remain exactly as it is, just like historic Palm Cottage, but we'll get more into that in just a moment. So with $100,000 to spend, you can spend that on completely redoing a kitchen and a couple of bathrooms. And if you've got a two-story house or a 2,000 square foot cottage or even a 1,200 square foot cottage, the amount of allowance goes out when you take care of heating, ventilation, air conditioning, electrical, and plumbing. I mean, that alone cuts into your $100,000 allowance. So removing the 50% rule is a huge aspect, because now someone could spend whatever they choose to. Doesn't matter. Sky is the limit. So that's a really big deal. Now, number two, local understanding. You cannot take each one of these individually. They are all interconnected. So even though I said you can spend what you want, there is a catch, okay? There is a local understanding needed of the four approaches to preservation. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that momentarily with the four approaches. NFIP refers to the National Flood Insurance Program. All of you who are paying flood insurance premiums, and boy, they just went up this year yet again. Flood insurance premiums are governed by NFIP. Now that's in the state of Florida. FEMA refers to the national organization. The National Flood Insurance Program is the state organization that manages floodplain, all right? Floodplain regulations will ask construction to elevate the house once there is some kind of project, right? If it's a significant rehabilitation, the house must be elevated. Well, if you take a 1936 cottage and you want to make rehabilitative change, and now you're forced to elevate it, now we don't have to do that. If someone chooses to elevate it because they're concerned about flood, that's up to them. Flood level is up to them. We don't require anybody to do one way or the other. But we've got homeowners who want to keep their historic house at the same level it was in 1936, because that, in their view, is what embodies the historic nature and understanding and the architectural history of the house. We applaud that. NFIP will waive the requirement to elevate the house if they follow one of the four approaches. Okay? We'll talk about the four approaches in just a moment. All right. Number four, there are no mandates, meaning someone can still tear down an historic house as it is today. If I lobbied for no tear downs in this legislation that was recently passed, I would have a lot of property rights people and certainly land use attorneys who would come up and disagree. Now, sadly, I can't see anybody, so I don't know if we have land use attorneys here or not, but nonetheless, you can, but this is through education. We've been able, in the last 6 months, there have been three houses that have been able to stay because of the society's legislation and an opportunity to encourage options through the four approaches. So we've diverted from teardowns. All right, I need to talk about the four approaches to preservation. The approaches to preservation are four in nature. All right, I see that I am coming close to my time, Carol. I'm going to continue until you say that I have to stop. We're near the end, by the way.
Oh, go right ahead until you come to the end of your PowerPoint. That's just fine.
Thank you. All right, four approaches to preservation. This comes from the National Register. This is not coming exclusively from Naples Historical Society. The National Register sets the bar, the criteria, the standards for historic rehabilitation. It is essential that everyone understand preservation happens to be the catch-all word for preservation, rehabilitation, restoration, and yes, reconstruction. So when someone says preservation, it includes a breadth of options. Now, what is the difference between all of this? All right. I could not include this in the PowerPoint because it's too big, and I can send this to anybody who would ask. Preservation, of these four approaches, preservation is the first approach to maintaining historic character. That's best exemplified by historic Palm Cottage. Nothing has changed inside or out other than a fresh coat of paint. So that is the highest level of standard to preserve. All right. The second one is rehabilitate. Rehabilitate is very substantial in its breadth. That allows alteration of a property. All right. And I'm not going to go into the specifics because there are about 800 pages that go into this. Restoration and repair includes an additional element of alteration, which could possibly include the addition to your historic cottage, which means you do not have to maintain the existing footprint from 1936. We have a house in the district. The gentleman, the homeowner, wanted to, it's a single story house, he wanted to add a second story to it. And I know you can do that, but it depends. The state of Florida right now is the one who adjudicates if you'll maintain character with your construction plans. All right, I'm going to come to that as soon as I finish with this. The plans that he sent in included adding a second story. The State Historic Preservation Office approved his plans in about 9 days. Typically, they take 30 days. I could not believe the quick turnaround with approval, and I wanted him to see this through to fruition because I wanted that to be the example that it can still maintain character as adjudicated by the state of Florida that watches this stuff like a hawk. He ended up not doing that and did something else to the back of the house, but that's an example of repair and alteration that can happen to an historic house. The fourth one, reconstruction or replace, refers to replacing it as it once existed. Now, the best and only example of this we have in the city of Naples is the Naples Pier. The Naples Pier was built in 1888, and over time, it has had modifications made for safety. Some of you will remember when there were no vertical slats in the fence along the side. Now there are, and of course, that protects young people or older people, whomever it might be, coming along the fence. But in 2014, I believe, a contractor redid a lot, including the bathrooms and the pilings. There's not one aspect of that pier that was built in 1888, not one. But it is still historic as adjudicated by the state of Florida, because it embodies and conveys the character of what made it historic to begin with. All right, so wrapping your brain around the allowances is probably the most important way to avoid misunderstanding. Because if someone says, you must meet my standards of perfection, which would be preservation approach number one, there has to be a way to acknowledge that you will encourage a teardown in Naples because of the market economics and the reality in which we live. So trying to get, I'd love to have everyone keep it as is, like Palm Cottage. But when someone is paying $2.5 million for property and is only allowed $100,000, or believe it or not, $30,000 to restore or rehabilitate their house, it comes down. The lack of understanding this was part of the institutional challenge from years ago, because there was not an acknowledgement of the removal of the 50% rule and the willingness of the National Flood Insurance Program to waive those elevation requirements. All right, moving forward in the future, we are in discussions with the city of Naples now on a few items. The certified local government will give the city of Naples the power to adjudicate design review, which means when someone has rehabilitative plans for an historic house, right now, the judgment of whether or not those plans will maintain character has to be done at the state level. I'd like for that to be here at the local level, perhaps through the design review board. They're already making design decisions, but there's going to have to be a very firm understanding of the breadth of options available. Because if people say no, it has to be a perfect example of preservation, because there's no mandate, the house will be torn down. So we are walking a fine fence with this, and this is something that we will be working with the city of Naples on right now. That includes design guidelines, which I do not recommend local design guidelines. I'd like to follow the guidelines that are at the state level. And at the national level, there's no reason to have something at the local level at this point, like they do in Old Town Alexandria or more. Like for like alterations is I have a metal roof, I want to replace it with a metal roof. That shouldn't be a big deal. Nonconformity waivers for historic houses. Every historic house is nonconforming by nature because they were erected before the land development code occurred in the 50s. So nonconformity waivers, you know, there's no one on council that everyone's looking at nonconformities for good reasons on height and density, but for historic houses, I very much believe the previous council and the current council understands the importance of preserving historic houses where we can. In the end, the last thing that we want is to have an historic house that is entirely inappropriate for the Naples Historic District. We see this around us right now, and I'm not going to shout out a couple of streets in Naples because that might be inappropriate, but there are some streets where there are houses that have a design unto themselves. To see a three-story glass house adjacent to the cottage. This can't happen, by the way. That's our property. How about that? That's our property there. To see that house would not be appropriate. I lost my image, so I'm going to stop sharing and come on board this way. We were right at the end, so that was really well timed. At this point, I know I went over. My apologies to you, Carol, and for those of you here listening to the webinar, but I'm open for questions now. And Carol, I defer to you.
Thank you so much. It was wonderful. And you know, those of us who wandered into Naples in whatever decade, at whatever age, we all have this kind of love for our beautiful little city. And to know that you are down there at the administrative office and the Palm Cottage headquarters, it just means so much to everyone to know that you're there taking an eye, keeping an eye on things.
Thank you.
Now, I got first question is from Siam. Thank you for a wonderful presentation. My question is about the old Naples Hotel, which I believe is the new hotel that is planned for the plaza on 3rd Street South. Has the Naples Historical Society been able to have input into the construction of this hotel so that it will closely resemble the one that existed in the early days? Thank you.
Thank you for that question. That's a very good question, and I'm asked it often. In full disclosure, Naples Historical Society advocated for the hotel as was proposed. So let's get that out there. That was approved in 2018, if I remember correctly, May of 2018. There was a lot of discussion about that and how it would ultimately have an impact downtown. Now, the hotel, as has been proposed, is number one, outside of the Naples Historic District. It's right there on the border. We weighed in on that because it's such a huge, has such a huge impact on the downtown area, particularly in the Naples Historic District. The architectural embellishments that will be included in this hotel, we believe will be able to demonstrate that the hotel has, they're going to have a cupola at the top, which was similar to what you've seen in the past, well, what you've seen through photos of the old hotel. But the old hotel took that entire parking lot all the way through to 13th Ave South. So for those of you who go to Tony Ridgway, we'll plug Tony Ridgway here. For those of you who've had lunch or dinner over there, the old hotel took more of that block, all right? So this is not going to take up that block. It will be smaller, but nonetheless, there was a lot of consternation about expectations of having it be smaller. Density was a very big issue back then, a couple of years ago. For some people, perhaps it still is an issue today. For the society, we saw too many houses that if people said, I expect you to have this standard, there were alternatives, and the worst alternative, the most dreaded, was tearing it down. There could have been other alternatives for this particular corner, including condominiums. So nothing wrong with more condominiums, but a hotel where a hotel once was the best way to go about this. And if you haven't seen the design schematics, that's available through the city of Naples because they're starting to put demolition fencing around right now. And so we are aware of what they were doing, and we continue to this day to advocate for it.
Wonderful. We'll look forward to that change. It's been quite a while sitting there empty. I've got something for you, Elaine, from the chat line from Bill Pope. He says, excellent, informative presentation. Many thanks for sharing all of this with us. My grandfather was a co-founder of the Alexandria Historical Society and saved many historical buildings there. That gives me great appreciation for what you and the Naples Historical Society are doing here. We are grateful for your work.
Thank you.
And here's a tough one from Joanne Husky. What do you predict Naples will look like in 10 years hence or 20 years hence?
Well, that's a big question. I used to refer to this initiative as Project 2050, thinking about what the vision would look like. I think it's important that our long-term vision include a district where architectural integrity and broad visual integrity is a part of it. I believe the district will remain intact. So that's the first thing. And that means there's still a lot of roll up the sleeves work to make that happen in education. In terms of the pockets of Naples development, there you can see it. You see it every time you turn on the City of Naples news, watch the Planning Advisory Board and Naples City Council. So there still is development. There's far more development east in eastern Collier County. And I know that because I sit on the board for the Historical and Archaeological Preservation Board of Collier County. There's Rivergrass. There's a lot happening out in the eastern part of Collier County. So 10 years from now, I very much believe that we will maintain what we've got in the district. In part, we're putting together a video, an educational video, that the theme on that will be our community's expectations, because I think it's important that we hold our new neighbors to expectations of what we want in keeping the Naples Historic District character, right? So, and that has to be done together. It's not going to be a McCarthyism sitting on the street shaming our finger at somebody. It has to be through education. 20 years from now, I would like to think the same thing. We've got legislation for the first time. If we go through this educational process and put out this video, I meet with people all the time who say, I had no idea. I'm going to recommend that to my homeowner. So we're turning the corner every single day. And I am optimistic. I'm a forever optimistic person.
Great. Joanne, I hope you'll be here 10 years hence and 20 years hence. I had a comment that I wanted to share with all of you participants out there. And I wanted to ask Elaine, which of the four approaches does this particular home fall into right now? And if you want to see a remarkable, what I call makeover, of a vintage Naples home, you just have to go to the western end of 11th Avenue South. It's number 15, 11th Avenue South. The house was built in 1920. So that house has been there since before the Tamiami Trail was finished, since before Collier County was carved out of Lee County, since before the train chugged into the Naples Depot. And rather than demolishing it, the new owners, whoever they are renovating it to some astonishing degree. Do you know which home I mean? It's the old
Susan. Yes, I do.
And I just wanted your comments or your thoughts on that type of preservation, such as it is.
Right. Everyone might think that this was a planted question, and I promise you it was not. This is a really great question. 15 11th Avenue South is in the district as an historic contributing structure, right? And I have not met the owners, but I've spoken with them about the house through their architect, and their architect I know. There were, let me back up. The process of being removed from the 50% rule and being exempt from the elevation regulations is to have the plans, the proposed plans, submitted to a design review entity, and that right now is the state of Florida, right? That's what I'm trying to get to come here to have home rule. These plans went back and forth to the State Historic Preservation Office four times.
Wow.
So they went up once, rejected. Went up again with modifications, rejected. Finally, and I was dealing with the architect and homeowner trying to bring everyone on board, and the architect, I think, did what he could, because no one can tell a homeowner what to do with their own house. Unless you've got Old Town Alexandria, where there are prescriptive expectations, but that doesn't happen overnight. So on the fourth trial, finally, approval was given by the state. So what you will see when it's final is a state of Florida approved historic house. And I would consider that a preservation approach number three. But having said that, because your question, Carol, hit two sections, I am pleased. I'd love it to have stayed the same, but you don't, the amount of funding that went into the house purchase with the dirt, we're talking many millions. So you can't keep a house that doesn't have a contemporary function. It's called adaptive reuse. You're allowed to do this and encouraged to do this. But people here didn't do this a long time ago because they said it had to be this or else. Well, the or else tore down a lot of houses. So the idea of embracing this house to have contemporary use is absolutely encouraged. And the owners of this house are doing this. They've added a couple of elements to make it even more livable. So the footprint is not the same. And for those who disagree with this, I say, well, it was approved by the state of Florida. So this is a perfect example of allowing that breadth. And thank God that there was a lot of patience, because had we said, and I did have, you know, one architect from this particular firm express, I guess I can say, a sincere discouragement on what was allowed or not by the state. We were able to pull them back, and they got what they wanted. It's going to be spectacular, and it is still historic, and that's a wonderful thing.
Yeah, wonderful. Well, it'll be a while before it's finished, but you all should go down and see it just as it is today, number 15, 11th Avenue South. Another thing I wanted to share with our attendees today is the amazing blessing that befell Naples in the early years when the mothers and fathers of the town must have had offers from certain developers from certain other parts of Florida who would come to Naples from time to time and say, oh, you have 4 miles of single family zoning along your beautiful beach. Surely you don't want to keep that. Certainly you want to have high rises and paddleboard restaurants and cafes. And those early mother and fathers, they said, no, thank you. They didn't choose to do that. And that is what makes Naples so unique and special. And if you want to appreciate this, I always say, go down to 12th Avenue South and walk out to the end of the pier. And don't look back until you get to the very end. And that's the one thing you can do safely now, go out for a nice walk out to the end of the Naples Pier. And then turn slowly and look back and look all the way to the north along the beach and all the way to the south along the beach. And you will see nothing but single family houses along our beach. And if you ever want to give thanks for the Naples that we all love, that's a really good way to do that. I've got another question coming in. Let me see what this one is. What provision of this legislation will prevent people like Hoffman and McCabe from buying property and doing anything they want? The city seems to allow them to do anything they want.
All right. The first comment I have is the word prevent. This legislation cannot prevent that kind of development. And trust me, I would have had a mandate in this legislation if I could. I had a land use attorney walk into my office back in 2014 or 15, and he said within 3 feet of me, 2 feet of me, I will vociferously oppose anything you do in this district initiative. And my comment to him was, take a deep breath and sit down and let's just talk about this, because we don't have mandates. This is going to be an educational program. And he said, oh, okay. So at this point, to stay ahead of that curve, we have got to educate the community, just as we did with this house that Carol just mentioned at the end of 11th, just as we do with other real estate agents, just as we do with architects and contractors, so they're aware of the tools they have available to them, so that there can be intellectual discussion of options. That to me is the biggest deal. I had a woman who lives in the district, not in an historic house, contacted me, this goes back a couple of years, contacted me and she said, I am so angry at my architect and contractor because they did not tell me that I bought a house in the district and that because I tore down a house and they didn't tell me this. Now this goes back about 9 years. So this was before this was on my docket. And of course it had existed attempts before, but I said to her, you know, you can't hold them exclusively responsible for this. And in terms of the city of Naples, what we've been able to do now is encourage relationships so that there is a mechanism in place where the society and the city can work together so that we can manage what we can. Now, having said this, most of our work, even though the legislation can go commercial or residential, it is primarily on residential, all right? Not commercial. This legislation deals with recognized historic structures in the Naples Historic District and potentially other individually listed houses outside of the district. There aren't any at this point. So it won't be commercial real estate, and that would address your question about Mr. Hoffman and Mr. McCabe.
Mm-hmm. Here's another question from Joanne. What years did Charles Lindbergh live in Naples?
Okay, so now you're testing my knowledge of Naples history on camera. I'm going to say the 20s, but I have said I am not a Naples historian. So that is my disclaimer here. I'm going to say the 20s. The house in which they lived is in the alley to the back of historic Palm Cottage. And I just learned that that alley wall that had been there after the Lindbergh baby kidnapping is going to be removed because it is starting to fall apart into the private yard. Now, if someone takes down that wall, am I going to scream? No, and I'll tell you why. The wall is causing damage, all right? Could they rebuild the wall? Sure, they could, but the truth is landscape is a part of this, no doubt. But I would rather have that gorgeous historic house. It's a huge, gorgeous historic house that spans half a block from the alley along Gulf Shore Boulevard all the way to Broad. It's really spectacular. So this is where we've got to have some perspective on where we go. With our expectations of perfection. You know, I've said to city council, I've been in front of them 63 times on various issues. All of it's recorded if you so choose to listen to some of this, but I've said many times, if you want perfection in the way you think preservation should unfold, buy the house and do it yourself. I mean, that is the surefire guaranteed way to do this. Now, could this city council decide mandates are okay? Perhaps so. I don't know. I'm not pursuing that because we've got legislation and we've got other irons in the fire, and I don't want to disturb the bear, if you will, while pursuing these other irons in the fire. So I think that we've got something that's reasonable. The difficulty is reaching new folks who are coming down. Some historic houses are bought sight unseen.
Really?
Yes. It just happened within yes. So, and I just worked with them. In fact, next Wednesday, I will be in front of City Council recommending final approval on their historic rehabilitation, which I think that they should get. They deserve it. Planning Advisory Board spent an hour on this about a month ago. They approved it. My hope is that City Council sees it, because if City Council doesn't, what happens? House comes down. There's no one who wants to be responsible for that. And trust me, that will be something to shout out. So I believe that we're in a position of strength. And it helps when we have more people like you, even if you don't, if you can't or choose not to explain what I shared today, to just let them know the society's got their act together. Call them if you want to know more, but there are ways to preserve, but I don't have a surefire way to manage it at this point.
Great. Are there any organized walking tours of the historic cottage district taking place right now?
Yes, that's a great question. We do. The Society has offered walking tours of the Naples Historic District every Wednesday for years. It's a fabulous presentation. I have an education manager who knows every aspect of this. It's 90 minutes for approximately 1 mile in duration, and then about 30 minutes inside the cottage, all right? Right now, it's about every Wednesday. We do have curtailed tour operations because of this nasty health pandemic. So we limit this to 5 people, but I encourage you, if you haven't taken a tour, you will see some of these fantastic historic houses. But the truth is, while I'd love to be able to pitch that, alleyways are public property. You know, if you don't disturb the neighbors, because that would just be wrong, drive in an alley. And whoever lives in a district, they're going to hear me. Don't tell them I said it. Say Carol sent you. But there's a wonderful way to enjoy these historic houses. And when you're driving along Gulf Shore or on Gordon, stop and take a look at these. Stop and take a look at the alley. It's just absolutely fantastic. And if we can have everyone help to convey that, we will be able to raise the bar for meeting community expectations to preserve charm and character in Naples.
Great. Let's see. I have a new question coming in. Here's one. Carol, we have your beautiful book, Naples Beach Homes, and it sits on our coffee table in our Naples home. I love reading the stories along with the paintings on Paul Arsenault. Thank you for the book. How nice. Thank you very much for the comment. We have done 3 printings of 2,000 books each, 6,000 copies, and right now we are all sold out. So your book is now a collectible.
May I add to that too?
Sure. Go ahead.
And I don't mean to embarrass you, Carol, and your dear husband, but this is, I think, important to let you know the importance of this book. The proceeds of that 6,000 books, which totaled well over $130,000, were donated to Naples Historical Society, specifically to help out in this effort surrounding the Naples Historic District. And because of their largesse and wonderful generosity, Carol and Robert Lair have been named as our honorary chairs for our Christmas gala in December of 2021. So next year, and we will be selling a few books that we've squirreled away because they all have been sold. So if you must have one, you may want to attend, but they will be available only to those who attend the event. So that's a shameless plug, but it's an important plug because the work we do at the Society is very consequential. And thank God we've got people like Robert and Carol documenting this through books like that.
Thank you for the plug. And we'll be at the dinner, of course, and hope that all of our friends from the Center for Critical Thinking and the Historical Society will be there. Here's a question. Elaine, has the Historical Society reached out with presentations to the condo associations in the Naples area?
We have tried to reach out to them, and that's been over the last 5 years and working through this. I will speak to any condo association, Rotary Club, neighborhood association that is available. So if your particular association has not had a presentation, I'll do it. 10 people, that's okay. I will do that. So I would encourage you to contact me and we can set something up through Zoom. Depending on how many people, we could physically distance under the Cheeky Pavilion outside. Of course, that can't accommodate many, and of course that's smaller because of rain potential, but give me a call and we can talk about this. Since you brought that up, I'd like to mention another group that I have been trying desperately to create some synergy with is NABOR. That's NABOR, the Naples Area Board of Realtors. There are, I want to say, 6,000 or 9,000 registered real estate agents in Collier County. Wow. That's an awful lot. Reaching them individually is impossible. So I have been to all of the major brokers and their firms, presentations of 3 people or 53 people, whatever. And I have spoken to the governance committee of NABOR twice. My pitch was not only what we were doing, because NABOR had concerns about overreach for private property rights, all right? NABOR was a part of that. But I asked them to consider adding on their MLS program a drop-down box to include Naples Historic District property. Three-bedroom, two-bath golf course property, three-bedroom, two-bath downtown property, three-bedroom, two-bath historic property. I was not successful in getting that. However, I have enlisted somebody else who might be able to carry some additional weight to see if we can try to push that forward. That would be, real estate agents are at the front line, right? If we can get them to understand that certain properties are in the district, we're halfway there. If I can get someone at my table to talk about the breadth of what's available, then we can start closing the loop on this. So reaching out to NABOR is also a part of it. But condo associations, please let me know. I'd be more than happy to speak with you.
Great. Any other comments or questions that you want to direct towards Elaine? Well, I am very happy that we were together today, September 10. It is the anniversary of Hurricane Donna in 1960 and the anniversary of Hurricane Irma in 2017. So thank goodness we are together on a day when whatever disturbances are forming are far, far out in the ocean. So I got to thank you so much, Elaine, for this terrific presentation.
Thank you.
Thanks to all you participants for the great comments and the questions. And remember that today's webinar has been recorded and it'll be posted in just a few days to our YouTube channel. So in closing, I want to invite you to attend our next Center for Critical Thinking webinar. It's the first one that we're doing specifically related to the coronavirus. It's called COVID-19, Its Impacts on Higher Education in America. And this format will be a moderated panel discussion featuring three of our own board members, Charles Capcella, Richard Conrath, and Larry Siegel, professors all. The date and time for that webinar will soon be finalized, so watch for details in the eBlast announcement. And now please keep safe, please keep healthy, and please keep thinking. Bye-bye. Bye, Elaine.
Bye, Carol. Thank you.
Bye.